go look up, just do a Google search for Shirt Factory, New York. And you'll find pictures of shirt factories from 1920. And they're old red brick buildings with big high windows, right? And rows and rows and rows of people, mostly young women, sitting at tables with sewing machines, looking up for the photo, like that, you know? Then look up a picture of startup, right? It's literally the same rooms and the same thing. It's big, long tables, only instead of the sewing machine, they've given you a MacBook Air, right? And you sit there and you crank out, like I was in what they called the content factory. Crank out some content. We need more content. How much content can you make in a day? I'm like, I shitloads, I'm fast. I've been a journalist a long time. I can make a lot of content. And it was like, the quality of the content's too high. We'd like to take the quality down, but the volume up. You know, okay, you know. And we were called content creators. That's our job. You're a content creator. Just sit there and churn out content, right? So it's factory work. It's digital factory work.
Thank you. I apologize for the suit. I don't really usually dress like this. I was in New York today. I had to put on my big boy clothes. I have this for funerals and court appearances and this. So I don't really have prepared remarks or I don't think it would be a good idea to like make you sit through an excruciating reading of a chapter. But I could tell you I would be happy to talk about the book or about Silicon Valley. A lot of people ask me about working on that show, and it's probably actually more interesting than talking about working at HubSpot. I could talk about sort of anything you want. I can tell you a little bit about my time there. And I also, there's a couple friends here that I worked with at HubSpot, and I wanted to say hi to them. And I don't know, maybe we should just throw it open to Q&A and make it like a discussion rather than a presentation. I really don't have a sort of, like I said, a prepared talk. Do you want to just, yeah, go ahead. And if it's, go ahead.
Sure. So you really highlight sort of the dark underbelly of working in the startup world and, you know, some of the flaws of it. So what would you say, I guess, to put a slightly positive spin on it too, how do you sort of overcome that? Or especially if you're a minority or you're a woman or you're part of the LGBT community, how do you overcome that kind of dark side?
You know, I don't know, and that's part of the thing I hope will happen from this book. Other than it, you know, I originally set out to write like a sitcom, right? Like a comedy show, like another tech show. Only it wouldn't be HBO; it'd be this kooky, crazy place with beanbag chairs and teddy bears, right? And you know, people getting graduated. And I thought that could be a really funny show. And the book was originally just that. Like, and the old guy goes in, doesn't get it, you know. And half of the humor is just me being clueless and an idiot and making mistakes and not knowing how to behave, right? So, but then as I was writing it, I realized there is a bigger story, right? There is a bigger story about like, wait a minute, there is this whole world where people over 40 or even younger are now told like, we just don't need you and we don't want you. And it's very open, right? It's like, it's not, you know, with racial bias and gender bias. I published an article yesterday on LinkedIn about this and said, you know, at least there in Silicon Valley, they will go to the effort to lie and say, you know, oh, we really want to do better and we're going to put out this report every year. And every year the report comes out and it says, Apple's diversity report shows little progress, you know, like every year, right? But with those things, they will at least pretend to want to do better. With age, they really don't even lie. It's like, really, like, no, why would we want anybody who's 40 years old? Like, you don't, you know, it's like, and so I thought maybe a provocative book that was funny would lure you in being funny and then make you think about some of these other things. And I don't really know, except I think maybe there has to be some kind of conversation. So this LinkedIn article I wrote has got like 1,000 comments in a day. Most of them from people my age, like overwhelming amount of people writing to me either in my own inbox or my own email or on LinkedIn saying, you can't believe what happened to me, blah, blah, blah. And they all want to tell you their story. And there's a lot of those stories. Like I realized I really tapped into something there that I wasn't even aware of, right? And then they were like, well, what can we do? And I don't really know. I mean, I don't know how to be an activist, right? But I think maybe you have to convince companies that that
actually embracing diversity isn't just like a nice thing to do and a way to get points on some sort of social justice warrior checklist, right? But that actually your company would do better, like your company would be better. And that's the real problem. The problem, I think, is that if you gave a bunch of venture capitalists and a bunch of founders, a bunch of people in Silicon Valley, if you gave them truth serum and you put them under and you said, what do you really think? They would tell you that what they really think is that the optimal way to run a company is to have a bunch of 20-something white guys running. And anything else is going to slow them down and make it worse. But they'll pay lip service to the other stuff because they know it's politically incorrect to say that. But if you gave them truth serum, I think they really believe we're optimized for the best return we can possibly get, right? And if there's a frat house culture, if there's a bro culture, that's okay too, because we'll pay the people off, we'll settle the lawsuits, and it'll still be better off for us in the long run. It'll still be cheaper and more efficient. And I think there's a certain amount of hubris to this because they're all young white men, and some of them are not young anymore. They're my age, but they used to be young white men. But I think there is a definite hubris to that, that thinks we are the smartest guys in the world, so we're going to get people like us to do it, right? And I think until they can become convinced that, in fact, they would make more money with a diverse workforce, that's not going to change, right? So that's a depressing as hell answer, and that's like really sucks. But I really do think that you know, diversity, like I would like to, I always worked, that's the thing that was striking to me. I had never worked in a place that wasn't diverse. When I worked at Forbes, I mean, not diverse in every way and not perfect, right? And but in terms of age, like I'd never seen a place that was all young people. Like Forbes, when I started, the editor there, I was in my 30s, the editor was this guy, Jim Michaels. He was 78 years old. His big claim to fame as a journalist was he was the one who broke the assassination of Mahatma Gandhi. Like, seriously, like, and that was like he had broken the Gandhi assassination. And he was a badass. He was like about this big. We used to call him Yoda. He was teeny tiny old guy, right? And he was mean. He was a mean little prick. Like, but he was a brilliant editor. And like the first week, when I first started there, I wrote what I thought was a kind of complicated tech story, and I get a call like, Mr. Michaels ready to see you. Like, you had to go down and see him. He rewrote everything. And I remember going down, and there's this like little old guy, and he used to work standing up. And I thought, he asked me, so what's your story about? And I sort of said, well, it's about this and that and Dell and distributors. And he like in 1 second said, so it's that the distributors have the PC companies by the balls and they won't let it go. And I was like, yeah, that's exactly it. He was like, okay, see you later, bye. And he rewrote it, cut it in half, didn't lose a thing in the story. Like, he was brilliant. And when he retired at 78, he went off and ran the TV business for Forbes. Like, he built the Forbes on Fox franchise. At Newsweek, then I worked for a guy who was 10 years younger than I was, like John Meacham, who won a Pulitzer Prize while I was working for him. And there were people like right out of college, and there were people who had been there for 40 years. I mean, there was just all kinds of different people there. I just had never seen a place where everybody was young. And then I never had seen a place where they said, oh, and that's not a mistake. Like, that's on purpose. And I was like, wow, that's, you know, kind of interesting to me. And I kind of got my teeth into that a bit. Anyway, I'm sorry, there's another, I'll stop rambling. Maybe there's another better question. In the back, sorry.
So just pick up the book and scanning through the author's note, you have this good line about the book. It's a story about how work itself has changed and how some companies claim to be making the world a better place, but in fact they're doing the opposite. I was wondering if you could discuss that. This idea that the companies that sort of propose to have this tremendous positive impact are in fact harming our society potentially.
Yeah, and I don't know if they're right. I think there's a new approach to work. I think Reid Hoffman at LinkedIn kind of started it. And as I started thinking more about how these companies are run, and across Silicon Valley, that there's a new approach to work, and Reid Hoffman wrote about it in this book a couple years ago, which whose title, of course, I can't now remember, but I mention it in my book. And his argument is, you're not coming here for a career. You're not coming to this place to work forever. You're coming for a tour of duty. You shouldn't expect this to last. This will last as long as it's good for you and good for me, right? But of course, it's like having a boyfriend, but he has all the power, right? Like, it's like, he's the billionaire. He's the guy hiring you, right? It's really, it's as long as it's good for him, right? And that short, and the idea is then you're going to work 30 jobs in your career. You're going to change jobs every 2 years. You're going to unplug, you're going to graduate, you're going to get fired or quit or be driven out. Then you're going to go spend months interviewing. Then you're going to get a job someplace. You're going to get onboarded and go through all that, fill out all the forms, get your health insurance, go through, get off the Cobra from the last one, get the new one. And then just when you figure out where the ping pong tables are, then it's time to go. Like, see you later, bye. And then you start all over again. And that there's a whole generation being told, like, that's going to be your career. That's your life, right? Like, and there's people, I guess, accepting that, like at 22, 23, 24, 25. And I think when you're that age, that seems okay. You're like, oh, okay, because you usually bounce around a lot in your 20s. But you get to be 30, 35, you get married, you have kids, you kind of want to be stable. You want to stay someplace for a while. And I think I don't really know how that's going to work out, right? Like, I don't know how the Reid Hoffman thing really works out. The only way it can work out, I think, is if you created a sort of API for companies, right, that all companies use the same standard for plugging in and plugging out. There was some sort of, like, thing, right? Maybe you could plug in and plug out faster. Everybody becomes a freelancer, and then you just plug in. But right now, what they're basically talking about is widgets, right? Turning us into widgets. Like, your workers are widgets. You're just, we plug you in for as long as we need you, spit you out. You know, Amazon came out today, Jeff Bezos, in his letter to shareholders last night, and said, you know, because they've been blasted for this cruel, brutal corporate culture they have. And at first, they sort of denied it and said, you know, last summer when the Times wrote this big expose, Bezos came out and said, that's not the Amazon I recognize. I don't even recognize the company they're talking about. Now today he said, well, okay, our company isn't, maybe our approach isn't right, but it's ours. And there's a lot of people who like it. And, you know, and if you don't like it, you're free to go someplace else. You know, like, I've been trying to work on an op-ed about this, and I feel it's like Mr. Burns in The Simpsons saying, you know, like, okay, yes, our workers are exposed to some nuclear radiation. But, you know, a lot of them are really happy with that. And if you don't like it, you don't have to work at the nuclear plant. You know, it's kind of like, you know, Jeff Bezos is like this evil genius guy. Oh, this is going to be on GBH. but anyway, so there's this idea that workers are not given the same rights and security that they once had. I mean, I think in my generation, we're caught in the middle of this, where my dad's generation, my dad's 82, but he worked his whole life at a division of AT&T, got out of college, and he had probably a dozen jobs, but they were all sort of within different divisions of AT&T, and he went overseas, and he did all these interesting things, and he had a fascinating, fabulous career, and he retired, not rich, but, you know, well off, and has a pension, and has health care for the rest of his life that they keep kind of nibbling back on, but whatever. And then I think my generation went into work sort of expecting the same thing. I remember going to Forbes thinking, I'm going to stay at Forbes for the rest of my life. Like, this is a great job. I'm in my 30s. I love this place. They have a fantastic pension. Like, we really literally had a pension, like the old-fashioned pension, and a 401k and great benefits. And I thought, oh, this is it. I'm not going to get rich, but I don't want to be rich. It's fine. I'm perfectly happy just doing this. I do work I like. And, you know, like an idiot, I left. But I mean, 10 years, I spent 10 years there, and I left for what I thought was a better job. But also, I could see that the media business was collapsing, and that's not Forbes' fault. I mean, that's also, I think, part of the pun of the title of my book, Disrupted, is that I think my generation has been disrupted. We all got into jobs in industries, because everything now is being blown up by the internet. It's not just the media. It's, you know, finance is about to get blown up by the media. Wall Street right now, those guys at Goldman Sachs think they're safe and they're making a lot of money. The TV business, where I've been working for the last few years, they don't see it coming. They're like the magazine business in 1996. You know what I mean? They all think this is going to be great. We're going to go to HBO Go. People will pay a la carte and we'll all still be rich. It's like, you know. But so I think there is this massive disruption taking place across industries, and the way companies are adapting to it is new companies are coming up with this new way of treating workers, and a new generation of people are coming out of school and buying into it because it's like what they accept as reality. I'm sorry, go ahead.
What you said earlier, it makes me think, like, the mainstream that you describe of the 20 plus people, like, that mainstream is just getting smaller and smaller and smaller.
What do you mean is, but I feel like every year there's a new crop of them coming out of school, you know?
Exactly, but it's a smaller and smaller demographic.
Oh, right.
Smaller population, so that means that everybody who doesn't fit it is quote-unquote diverse.
Oh, I see what you mean. Yeah, diversity means anything that isn't, yeah, exactly right.
Yeah, exactly. So that means there's more of us, and we're, you, me, and pretty much everybody in this room who's not a, you know, 25-year-old white male, we're all in this together, and we're all trying to freelance our way up now.
Right, and that's a lot of people who've written to me in the last day about that LinkedIn piece are saying the only solution I think there is for people our age, my age, there is you go start your own thing. You become a contractor or a small business. It isn't really a startup, but it's like a, you know, thing. You become independent. But yeah, I should also say that, like, I'm very aware. Like, I never felt old. before I went to HubSpot. I was aware that I was getting older, but I never felt like an old person. And now, especially writing this book, the real risk of it is, like, now you're forever pinned as the old guy who wrote the book, right? And sure enough, like, I see this stuff on Twitter. Somebody posted a thing saying, here's my review of this book. And it's a picture from The Simpsons of Grandpa Simpson, and it says, old man yells at cloud, right? I was like, shit, that's become me. And I'm not even old yet, not really old, you know what I mean? I hope another 5-7 years to live, but, no, seriously, I bought some shoes recently. This is a little off topic, but I bought some nice shoes. I'm wearing them now. And no, these aren't the ones. Anyway, I went to Allen Edmonds, and you know, they have these expensive shoes, right? And the woman's like, and I'm like, whoa, that's a lot of money for a pair of shoes, you know? She's like, well, you'll have these for the rest of your life. And I was like, lady, I gotta tell you, not a big selling point for me. They don't really, you know, unless I can hand them down to my son, you know? Like, but, anyway, I'm sorry. I should tell a better story. But anyway, so that was what I was trying to wrestle with in the book. And this idea that, so are they making the world a better place? To get back to your long way, back to your question. Like, I don't know. I think Reid Hoffman's approach has made the world a much better place for Reid Hoffman, right? He's worth $5 billion, right? And then he's running a sweatshop, right? And then Jeff Bezos is running basically a digital sweatshop. And he's worth, I don't know, $50 billion, some ridiculous amount of money. His company doesn't make a profit. His workers are treated like shit. Right? But he's rich, so I guess he's making the world a better place, right? So I think a lot of this is, you have to ask, who are they making the world better for? And I'm not like, I'm like Grandpa Simpson yelling at clouds. Like, I love Facebook. I love a lot of things that have come about on this. But I feel like the one thing that's getting left behind is how workers are treated in this world. And we have no unions anymore. We're kind of, we're sort of on our own, and we get played off each other, right? We get told, like, screw you, you're out, I can hire this guy. Like, you know, at HubSpot, they have a concept called VORP, which is in the book, which is, by the way, available for sale here, 20% off. But there's a concept called VORP. They have two concepts of how they deal with workers. And when you get your annual evaluation, my second to last day there was my evaluation. And one is HEART, which is, what does it mean to be HubSpotty? And there's five traits, H-E-A-R-T. Humble, effective, adaptable, remarkable, transparent. How much heart do you have? How HubSpotty are you, right? And it's like zero, right? Like none, right? Like, so, I think I got like a 2 on heart. And I was like, could we break that down? Could we take the 5? How did you score that exactly? Could I see the data? Like on humble, where was I? Obviously not, like 0, right? But transparent, very, too much, probably a 7, right? It was on a 0 to 5 scale. The one was, and then there was VORP. Anyway, so I wanted on the heart thing, I wanted them to add up all 5, divide by 5, and then tell me how they arrived at 2. And then I was hoping maybe I was really like a 2.7 and it could be rounded up to a 3, but like, didn't go there. But then on VORP, VORP is called value over replacement player, and it comes from baseball. Look, this guy's like shaking his head, right? I know, and it's like, and VORP means, basically, in baseball, it's like, how do we set a price on a player? How much is that shortstop worth? Well, how much could the, and the idea was, how much would we have to pay for just an average shortstop, right? Whatever that dollar amount is a year. And then how much are we paying you? And are you worth that delta? And if not, maybe we should just get the average guy, right? So they use that at HubSpot. So first you get your heart, which is like kind of touchy-feely and ridiculous and how softy HubSpot are you. Then the next one was VORP, like, why are you worth more than what we could pay you? And my last job there was like, I was literally running a podcast and I wasn't even on the podcast. I would get the water. They really wanted me to leave, right? So I had a job where I was the admin for the podcast, right? Like 52 years old, I'm running around fetching water for people and like putting their microphones on, like, are you okay, you know? And like literally it was a job that the bosses admin originally was going to do. He sent her to a 2-week podcasting training class, and then they decided, no, we'll just have this idiot do it instead. So I'm doing this job, and I'm getting paid like pretty well at this place, right? Because I got a good deal going in. So I'm thinking on VORP, I'm going to have like negative $1 million, like, right? Because I mean, like, they could pay anybody. You could get an unpaid college intern to do what I did, and they would probably do it better, right? Because they wouldn't be, you know, pissed off about it like I was, right? So, and then like VORP, I think I got a 3. Right, or 2 or 3, and I was like, That's ridiculous. So they're just pulling numbers out of their ass, right? But it's all about being a data-driven organization. So fine, that makes sense. But that VORP metric to me seemed like the cruelest thing in the world. Like, I've had job reviews at other jobs. At Newsweek, you would sit down with your editor at the end of the year, and she'd say, like, okay, you know, you got a cover story. We'd really like it if you did 2 a year. You should have done some more on that. And like, but you're doing great on the web. You know, whatever it was, you had a conversation, and you know, I mean, if you were really screwing up, I guess you'd have a bad conversation, but it was just a conversation about where you're going and how things are. What do you want to do this coming year? It wasn't like, let's make up some made-up Candyland number for like how good you are, how bad you are, you know? So I think in that way, being treated like that by a company, and these kids are all coming out of college and accepting, like, that's work, that's life. It's like, it's basically a factory. I mean, literally, that place is an old furniture factory, right? It's a 19th century furniture factory. I don't know if you know this. You know the term a Davenport, which is a kind of couch? It was made in that building. That was the Davenport Furniture Factory. Oh, Davenport, is a Davenport a couch or an armoire? Maybe it's kind of an armoire. It's a couch, right? I'm such a wordsmith. I know this stuff. Look at the bookstore guys are like, yeah, idiot. So what is it? What is a Davenport? What is a Davenport? It's a couch. So, oh, see? So that was the company that created it. And it's got red brick walls. It looks like, when I was 19, I dropped out of college because I was kind of a mess up. And I went to work at Malden Mills in Lawrence in a textile factory, and I worked there for like two and a half years. And it's an old red brick building with high ceilings and loud machines, right? And you walk into a lot of these dot-coms, and it's basically an old textile mill or an old factory that's been stripped out, cleaned out, and some of the asbestos is gone. And then I actually looked up pictures. This is a fun exercise to do sometime. Go look up, just do a Google search for Shirt Factory New York, and you'll find pictures of shirt factories from 1920. And they're old red brick buildings with big high windows, right? And rows and rows and rows of people, mostly young women, sitting at tables with sewing machines, looking up for the photo, like that, you know? Then look up a picture of startup, right? It's literally the same rooms and the same thing. It's big, long tables, only instead of the sewing machine, they've given you a MacBook Air. Right? And you sit there and you crank out, like I was in what they called the content factory. Crank out some content. We need more content. How much content can you make in a day? I'm like, I shitloads, I'm fast. I've been a journalist a long time. I can make a lot of content. And it was like, the quality of the content's too high. We'd like to take the quality down, but the volume up. You know, okay, you know. And we were called content creators. That's our job. You're a content creator. Just sit there and churn out content, right? So it's factory work. It's digital factory work. That's the other thing I realized about this. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Question. Yeah, let's think the huge difference is that technology, I mean the computer, when that all happened, it changed really the work. And the fact that companies, especially startups, or people think they can make billions of dollars, like some people, that's
right. Like that's never changed, right? We're detecting a pattern on that one. Yeah.
Usually companies want young, maybe men, because they don't have to take care of the kids if there are
right.
kids. And they will work long, hard hours.
Yep.
And that's usually, I mean, you see it with lawyers or doctors out of medical school. I don't think that's unusual.
Well, but I think what's unusual is this. Can you imagine an industry other than professional sports where the owners of the business said and everyone accepted that at 35 you're done, 40 you're done, right? I mean, okay, basketball players, yeah, your knees, right? But like my sister-in-law, for example, is a surgeon. To back this up, the argument in favor of that is often, yes, the young people will work harder, but they never say that. They'll work harder and get paid less. That's the reality, right? Long hours. But what it always is in tech is different because tech is changing so fast that old people just can't learn fast enough, you know what I mean? There's this sort of, Amy Cuddy at Harvard Business School has written this amazing research. She did a lot of research on age discrimination. And the two things are, the stereotypes of old people are that we are warm and fuzzy, we have a high warmth ratio, but low competence, right? So we're happy, just stupid, right? You know, And when you think about it, like when you think of a 95-year-old, you're like, oh, isn't she sweet? You know what I mean? Like,
you wouldn't want her driving a car, right? But like, but anyway, so that's the idea that old people can't learn fast enough, that coders can't learn a new programming language. They have to. So the new kids coming out know Python, and God, we need them, right? My argument is like, I don't think a 50-year-old can't learn Python. Like, I think that's ridiculous, right? Maybe they don't want to. In that case, then they're taking themselves out of it, right? But so, my sister-in-law is 40. She's a surgeon. She's a colorectal surgeon at Stanford, right? She has just barely started her career because she had to go to med school, then a residency, then she had to do this fellowship that took years. And now, I mean, it's just a few years ago, it seems to me, because at my age, the years go by, but just a few years ago, really, she started actually her career as a surgeon. And she still is learning. She's operating incredibly complicated robotic surgical machinery. She's doing work that's both intellectually very rigorous and physically requires a great amount of dexterity. Very, very demanding work, much more demanding than, say, being the social media manager who has to send out a tweet every hour, right? And she's 40. She seems to be perfectly capable of doing this, right? I think at 50 and in 60, she'll still be operating on people and doing this very complicated, difficult work. So I don't buy this idea that tech companies use, that just old people just can't do it, right? I think it is just about churn and burn. We'll bring you in, we'll burn you out, we churn you out, and then we get another crop of young kids. And we don't have to pay you. And what they don't want, think about it, you know, right when you have kids, that's also when your healthcare costs go up, you know, because now you're on a family plan, it costs more to take care of you, and you're also out more, and you're not, you have to go to your kids' things. I actually did an interview with WBUR a couple days ago, and the woman was a little bit like on the other side of this, like, you're a grumpy old guy, and why weren't you happy? This sounds great. I would love to work at HubSpot, right? And a lot of people do love it, right? But at one point she said, well, you can't really blame companies for wanting younger workers who don't have these encumbrances like children. And I was like, wait a minute, stop. And she's like, well, no, I have a kid. I was like, I know, okay, but you just kind of like think about the bias you just revealed there, that as an employee, that person has an encumbrance. Well, I have two kids. I don't want to think of them as encumbrances, and I don't want to think that, oh shit, if I have kids now, I can't work. And I also realized that as a white male, this is something that women, every woman in this room has dealt with your whole life, right? And now I get it. This is the other thing. It's like, you know, you're late to the party on this, right? But that's what my wife says, right? Like, you know, but right, I don't want to have to think of my kids as an encumbrance. And I don't think companies, well, maybe they are better. Maybe they really are just ruthlessly better served by saying, bring in new kids, throw them out before they have kids of their own and get more kids. And we'll just keep doing that. We'll just keep training new ones. Maybe that's, if you were totally Machiavellian, if you were totally just Dr. Evil, you'd be like, that is really the way to do things. I just felt like writing the book to call bullshit on that, right? Or at least call it out. Like that, let's call it that. If that's what it is, let's call it that. Because I don't buy the arguments about old people. I think I'm a better writer now than I was 20 years ago, although I was not very good 20 years ago. But you know, I think I'm better at what I do now than I was 10 years ago. I think people get better at what they do. You know, there's this whole Malcolm Gladwell thing that everybody in tech likes to talk about, the 10,000 hours. Well, if you're an employer, why wouldn't you want to hire someone who already put in the 10,000 hours on someone else's dime? You get the benefit of all the expertise that they've developed over the years for nothing, right? This is like such a crazy rant. I'm so sorry. But anyway, does anybody have, yes?
What do you think HubSpot loses by not having, you know, a representation from an older, like that perspective for the customers or for their business, actual business, if they're trying to automate marketing systems, perhaps, you know, with older workers that have to...
They're selling to older people,
yeah.
Right? Yeah, right? And there are people in their 40s there, you know? And there was one guy older than me. There was one guy in his 60s who's a consultant, who you guys know. And he found me, like, right away. I'll tell you that story later. I'll try to answer your question. I think what they lose is a diversity of point of view. They lose people who challenge the status quo, who I think it's very easy to take very young people who have never had a job before and maybe a little intimidated and a little scared and say, this is the way we do things and this is great, and people just accept that, and it's a very unquestioning, unchallenging kind of environment where it's very cult. What's that?
Docile
and cult-like. But it's also very energetic. It's not passive, like docile, like people. I mean, it's very energetic, high energy, but it's like up with people, right? Like it's just really, and only some of us will get that reference, right? Like, if you're too young, you won't get it. But right, you can bring people in, but I think that's a detriment to an organization, to not have the people who like to break
what is it, furniture breaker? You know, and people who rattle things up and say, you know, no, this is bullshit, blah, blah, blah. Like, even if you end up going with the other one, I think having the debate and having the open argument and having multiple points of view is enriching for an organization. I have no real data to back that up other than, you know, my anecdotal gut sense of that. But I think that that's the risk, is you bring in all one kind of people and they all think one kind of thing, you can get really blindsided as a company, as an organization, yes.
So what's the tech company say that's doing it right? Like, that's actually, you know, has the right amount of diversity, or at least not right, because I don't think there is a right amount.
Yeah.
Sort of better than the rest of them.
I honestly don't know. Like honestly, you know, so Apple, Google, and Facebook started producing this diversity report every year, right? When you look at it, though, it's dismal. Like, it was great that they put it out, and that's a first step, right? And but it doesn't really get any better every year. I'm sure there are. I'm sure there are companies that are putting more effort into it. Oddly enough, it might be like IBM, a company I covered for a long time, that has people who stay over. And mind you, they have a lot of issues. If there are any former IBMers here, you know there are certain issues there. But maybe IBM, I don't know, and HP. And then the argument would be, well, would you rather work at Facebook or at HP? I don't know. Like, you know, like, you go work at some dinosaur and it's great and diverse. But I don't know. I think I don't really know if this is a shining example of a great company that really has it. And it's just my own ignorance. There probably are some, probably people here who know an example of one, but I just don't. Sorry, is there any other questions? Oh, Barb, she's a ringer. I brought her with me. She's my friend.
What have you heard from, you said there's some HubSpot people here.
Yeah, the guy's looking at me like I saw all pissed off behind you. He's like looking at me like, fuck you, man. He's texting. He's sending everything back to the cult, the mothership right now. What have I
heard? Is the bear gone?
The teddy bear? As far as I know, Molly the teddy bear exists, but I don't know. I haven't been in there in a while. There was a teddy bear. Like, see, do you want to hear the teddy bear story? I'm going to ruin the whole book for you. I'm going to tell you that, and I'm going to tell you the old guy story. So the one old guy who knew me, who found me, like my first day or first week, this guy comes in, he's got like white hair, even grayer than mine, right? And he's like, hey, I heard you coming in here. I'm like, whoa, hey, you know? He's like, we should hang out, we should have lunch. And below, I said, cool, let's have lunch. So people are very friendly there. So we started having lunch, right? We would meet for lunch, and we would go over to the Galleria Mall, and we would sit there in the food court and get like Chick-fil-A sandwiches, right? And we sit there eating our Chick-fil-A and bitching about, like, these kids, blah, blah, blah. Like, he was like, he, you know. And then I realized, and there'd always be people, HubSpotters coming in and out, like, hey, and they'd say, hey, you know. And then I realized, like, what we were to them. We were like the guys that I see at Dunkin' Donuts in the Windbreakers, you know, in the morning. We sit there for like 3 hours talking about, like, World War II and how great it was, and you know, the Elks Club, and they hate Obama. I was like, oh shit, we've become those guys. Like, we're and I said, like, we can't do this anymore. Like, we can't, if we're gonna have lunch, like, let's meet out in the suburbs on a day when we're both working at home. Like, we'll meet out in Lexington, because I don't want them seeing us together. Like, if we get in a pair, we're more vulnerable. Like, we can get hunted down. You know, because we'd be like walking to lunch together. It's like, you know, it's easier to take us out. And I just thought, like, and this is terrible, but I also thought, like, he's a lot older than me, and he really looks old, and I don't want to be with him, you know what I mean? Like, I don't know, man, like, you know? I want to be with the 35-year-olds and pretend like I'm just a little older than them. I don't want to be just a little younger than you, you know? But, and then at one point he got cool glasses. He's a friend of mine, right? So he got really cool glasses, very hip glasses. I did the same. We both got out and went out and got, like, cool glasses. Then I realized, like, oh, this is really messed up. I can't do this anymore. I put them back. I had to go back to my old glasses, but he still got them. And he's cutting it, like, he's making it there. He's been there for a few years, and it's like, it's working out for him. But I think he's an exception. So that's my old man friend story. And then the teddy bear story is that I'm in there for about, I don't know, a few months, and one day we get this thing, say, they're very good at like putting stuff out on social media. It's like what they do, right? They're a marketing company or marketing service. So they're really good at like spamming stuff. Like, you know, if they want to get a message out, they do these things called lazy tweets, where you'll get a tweet and all you have to do is click and it's already written for you. It goes under to your name, but it's already done. You don't have to write it. So like recently, Halligan, the CEO, wrote an article someplace. And it's kind of funny, but I noticed about 50 of these people all tweeted the same thing within like an hour of each other, like the same text, the same photo attached to it, like, hey, go read Brian's story. Now, there's anything wrong with that, but it's kind of spammy, right? So we get a note saying, Dharmesh has this new article out, and we want everybody to get out on Twitter, and everybody hit the social and just like promote this thing, promote. We want to get clicks, we want to drive traffic to this thing on LinkedIn. It was on LinkedIn, right? And like that doesn't happen by accident, right? Like 500 people are all told at the same time, go tweet this, right? So I'm like, okay, you know, that's cool. Like, this is marketing. But I should at least read the article first. Yeah, whatever. And the article says, at HubSpot, we believe in something we call SFTC, because they have acronyms for everything. SFTC, solve for the customer. Always be SFTC. Whatever you do, solve for the customer. You know, you'd be like, can I go to the bathroom now, or is that solving for the customer? I don't know. I'll wait till noon. But so they were always solving for the customer. So, and he said, so what I've come up with is, I like to have the customer present at every meeting and every decision. If you're into talking about renting new office space or any decision, the customer, we should think, what does this mean for the customer? So I put an empty chair at the desk, at the table, at the management table. And the empty chair is the customer. And that reminds us of the customer. But then I realized that wasn't enough, so I got a teddy bear. And I named the teddy bear Molly. And I bring Molly to meetings and I put her at the table. She sits at the table at the management meeting. And she is the stand-in for the customer, right? And he has a picture of this bear that he posts on LinkedIn with the CMO next to it. And the bear has like this little Red Bull in front of it, and it's looking like really pissed off, like it's gonna cut someone a new butthole, you know? And it's like Molly the pissed off teddy bear. And I'm like, this is mental, right? This is completely insane, right? This is really nuts. Like if the managing editor at Newsweek had come out and said, we believe in writing for the reader, so I bring a teddy bear to every story meeting and we ask the teddy bear, what do you think, right? Like, I mean, they would never live that down, right? I mean, people would be buying teddy bears, everyone would have a teddy bear, they'd have teddy bears in leather and bondage outfits and stuff. You know, it would be horrible, right? I mean, you would never, ever live that down. But here, nobody said anything. And I actually leaned around my monitor to the guy who faced me. I was like, dude. He's like, wow. I'm like, did you read that article? He's like, yeah. I'm like, no, the one with the teddy bear. He's like, yeah. I was like, that's messed up, right? And he's like, no, I think it's really cool. I'm like, no, come on, that's crazy, right? He's like, no, it's really, you know, these startups. And I was like, okay, and this guy had worked at Google. I'm like, so wait a minute. Are you telling me that when you were at Google, if Larry Page wrote an article saying he's bringing a teddy bear to meetings, everyone at Google, you guys would have all been just like, great, let's all bring teddy bears. Like Larry, you know, Larry wants us to have teddy bears. And he's like, well, you know, but startups are different, they're eccentric. And I realized at that moment, like, holy shit. Like no one here will ever break ranks on anything, you know? When you get fired, they call it getting graduated. And you get a memo saying, hey, just want you to know that Bill has graduated and he's taking his superpowers off on his new adventure. Like literally, that's the words. Like, we're all rock stars with superpowers who engage in delightion, which is like meaning delighting the customers, right? So there's all this language, this shifted language, which I'm like, holy crap, right? And so Bill's graduated, we wish him the best as he goes off on his new adventure, and then you look over and you realize the guy's desk is empty, everything's gone, he's just, boom, vanished, like a Spinal Tap drummer, just boom, up in smoke, like he's just gone, right? And it's like, and nobody ever talks about him ever again. And if you try to bring up like, hey, what happened to Bill? Did he fuck up in some way? I'm sorry, this is gonna be in GBH, sorry. Children will be listening to this. No, but like, did he do something wrong? Did he cross someone? People be like, I don't know. I think he was great. I don't like him. And like, boom, like nothing. Like I was like, wow, this is crazy. So that's my two stories. Is this guy in the back with a question?
So you're talking about how there's kind of like an expiration of the workers being about 40, and with like that kind of demographic of coming out of this kind of bubble, growing. What are those people going to do, especially when that demographic is big enough for their growth?
You mean people who are now, say, 25, when they become 35?
Yeah.
I don't know. I actually literally got an email today from a guy in San Francisco who's 32 telling me that he worries about his age because he's no longer the guy right out of college and he feels old and he doesn't know if he can get another job. It's like, whoa, right? And my boss at HubSpot was 43 and he was old. And he described HubSpot as like Logan's Run, the movie where they kill you at 30 to you know, stop overpopulation. It's just like, you know, it's just like a dystopian planet. And he actually said to me once, I figure if I don't strike it here, I got maybe one job left, maybe two, and then I'm going to be 50 and no one will hire me. And I was like, oh, wait a minute, really? Anyway, so I don't know what, I think that's when maybe this changes, right? Although there's always a new batch coming out. That's why I'm sort of kind of running around with my hair on fire, like, how is this sustainable if we throw people out after 2 years in a job? How is this going to be, how are you going to build anything really great if you're always churning through your workforce and then you have this big pool of unemployed people roaming around looking for jobs? How are you going to, you know, build the next microprocessor, the next transistor, the stuff that Bell Labs did? That doesn't happen with, you know, a quick in and out on a job. I'm sorry.
Well, don't you think it's a factor of self-selection, too? Because I think, like, in terms of women in the workplace, what Cheryl says a lot of the time, too, is like, well, there's a lot of women just self-selecting out of the pool because they don't see other women in the company. So is it
partially
that, too? Like, there's not enough older people in startups because they're self-selecting out.
But where do they go? They're not into the startup life, you mean?
Yeah,
so they self-select out and they find something else to do.
There's like, these kids are my son's age and I don't want to be here. I'd rather work at like PTC or General.
Wendy's. I'd rather work at like fast food, right? I get your point. You could self-select out. But here's the thing that also strikes me, right? This is probably the most important industry on the planet in our country. Generating more wealth than's ever been generated in human history, let's say, a lot of money. And it is basically saying to a vast majority of the population, you have no place here. You can't participate in this. All this wealth creation, that you don't have any role here. So you might self-select out, but you might be someone like saying, you know, I'm a 45-year-old woman, but I'd like some of that money. I'd like some of that, you know, I'd like some of that equity. And that I find amazing, that this super progressive, super important industry is also like the least diverse industry on earth. It's incredible. And it's like proud of it, sort of. I mean, they kind of pay lip service to doing better. But like to say to women, like, well, we can't accommodate you, like, because you're going to have a baby? Like, I mean, I don't know. I don't think that's right. I don't think it's progressive. I just find that essentially basically unfair, that bargain. And I don't think Cheryl, I mean, Cheryl, you sound like you know her. Do you?
No, I wish I knew her, though. Do you know her?
I've met her, yeah. And I think, you know, it's different for her than for other people, but I think she's had to make trade-offs too, right? But, but you know, she's obviously decided to, like, commit and stay on that path. It's not easy for everybody to do that, to work both paths without some accommodation, but I feel like companies should. Marissa Mayer had somebody build a nursery next to her office at Yahoo. Well, we can't all have a nursery built next to our office. But and I also admire Marissa Mayer tremendously. She gets a lot of grief at Yahoo, but I actually think I think no one could run Yahoo. I think, you know, Jesus could come back and, like, you know, be like, no, thanks. Don't want the Yahoo job, you know what I mean? Like, I'm working at Facebook, yeah. I mean, it's like an impossible task. What is Yahoo? Yahoo's just this blob. It's like a bunch of different stuff. And there's now talk, wasn't there a story this week that Sheryl Sandberg is up for something?
Disney.
Disney, right. Which would be brilliant, right? Like, I think she's the brains behind Facebook. That's also the story that never gets written, that Zuckerberg was the guy that, the smartest thing he ever did was hire Sheryl Sandberg and then have her bring in all these other people from Google who knew how to run a business and knew how to make money, right? Otherwise, they would be Snapchat, you know, like, right? She's an incredible business person, right? And why are we saying to? And she's kind of the exception, right? I mean, I'm glad that she's doing what she's doing with Lean In, and I think that will have an effect. And what, probably to your earlier question about how we change it, like, people like that will change it, right? Talking about it, and she's in a position to do something about it, right? I'm sorry. I know you've this guy. He hasn't asked a question. I'm sorry. Go ahead. 5 minutes. Yeah. Right.
What you're saying mainly, do you think applicable to startup culture, or do you think it's widely applicable to the tech industry?
Then it kind of gets to be like, what is the tech industry? Right. That's a very good point.
Period.
Well, it is, except, like, I mean, do you call tech companies like, is Accenture a tech company? I mean, at some point, or IBM even, is IBM really a tech company anymore? I don't know. Or HP? Right. I mean, I know what you mean. I think it's endemic in startup culture. I think startup culture, this last batch, especially in the last 10 years, one big difference to me was that there was a time not so long ago, again, Grandpa Simpson, but like when, you know, when Microsoft was founded, the VC said to Bill Gates, you got to bring in John Turley. You need adult supervision. You don't know how to build a company. And as recently as Google, there was this idea that you had to bring in Eric Schmidt for some kind of, you know, adult supervision. The the conventional wisdom in the last 10 years has been that you don't need to do that, that you're better off to leave the founder alone, no adult supervision. So to answer your question, I think it's this diversity problem is a problem in a lot of big tech companies, but it's especially so in startups where you've given Evan Spiegel, you know, I don't know how much money he's raised, $800 million, like a lot of money. And he goes out and tries to maybe hire some adults, but they can't stand him, so they all leave, right? But the idea was Evan Spiegel doesn't need a Sheryl Sandberg. Like he didn't need, even Mark Zuckerberg kind of knew he needed someone older and more experienced to come in and help him. But I think this last batch of startups in the last 10 years have been unique in that idea that it's absolutely okay. And then what happens is you get this bro culture. So you get these rich guys who are rich with a lot of money who are left to their own devices and just hire other people like themselves, and it perpetuates, right? And I think that's unique in startups. That's not really the case at Apple. I mean, Apple probably has a wider age range, although if you look at the average age, Facebook, Google, and Apple, they're still pretty young. Like Google especially and Facebook are still in the median's like 20-something. Yes, I'm sorry.
So how did the FBI get involved with your book?
Oh. Yeah, I can talk about that. So the question is, how did the FBI get involved with my book? And the answer is, I would really like to know. Like, so here's the thing. I left saying and wrote a blog post. Sometime after, a few months after I left, saying, oh, you know, I'm going to write this book about my ridiculous attempt to become a marketing guy, because it was, you know, looking back on it in retrospect, it's like, what was that? Was ridiculous. That was so stupid, right? And great. That was February. In June, late June, I got some emails from the CEO at HubSpot asking me, what's the book about? Pretending he had just heard about it. Ah, I just heard you, right? What's this thing about a book? Oh, I just saw this article in Wired. I knew he knew all about it, right? And I said, well, it's about, you know, being an old guy, blah, blah, blah. We went back and forth a couple times. And then literally like a month after that, July 29th, I'm at home working, sitting at my desk, and someone sends me a link to this press release saying, actually the way they worded it was that someone had been promoted to CMO. And I was like, oh, that idiot's a CMO. So and then it was kind of like, and then in the second graph, Barry Down was like, that's because we fired our CMO for cause. The other guy quit before we could determine what to do with him, and then the CEO's been sanctioned. And that's all I knew. And people are writing to me, and the Globe's calling me, and these reporters are pestering me. Like, the Facebook alumni page was on red alert saying that I had somehow done this to these guys. Like, I had ratted them out and got them in trouble. I'm like, I still have no idea what happened. And then people start going, well, you probably got hacked. They probably hacked your computer and tried to get your book. Because they said in the press release it was an attempt to procure the manuscript. And I was like, that's like the worst crime on earth, right? Like, it's just like the Rupert Pupkin approach to getting a book. It's like, the simple approach is you ask for it, you know, or then you get a lawyer and you demand it. But like, you know, no, we're gonna hack your computer, and then we're gonna, you know, so they get this like crazy like gang that couldn't shoot. This is what I'm thinking. I don't know, right? I asked the company, they won't tell me. So someone says, you're gonna hear from the FBI. Trust me on this. I mean, not an involved party, but someone who, you know, a lawyer, says to me, I don't know what this is, but if I were you, I'd get ready. Sure enough, the FBI calls me, I go in, and the assistant U.S. attorney's there, and I'm like, still kind of baffled, like, and they're like, you probably have a lot of questions for us. I'm like, yes, I do. I have so many questions for you, and I'm still writing the book. So they're like, well, we're not going to be able to answer any of them. I was like, oh, but we want you to answer all of ours. I'm like, well, okay. So, and they asked me all these questions, like, what's in the book that would possibly make someone go to such length? I'm like, really nothing, like nothing, right? I mean, it's a funny book, blah, blah, blah. Like, what's not in the book that they might have thought was in the book? I'm like, whoa, that's the billion-dollar question. And if I knew that, trust me, I wouldn't tell you assholes, right? Like, because you're not telling me anything, right? Believe me, then I'd have a blockbuster, right? But then I'm thinking, shit, there probably was something really good, and I'm like such a great journalist that I spent a year and a half there and never saw it, right? Like, what was it? Was it in the nap room? Like, you know, was it, you know, I don't know. So I said to him, I don't know. I threw out a few really random things, and they were like, nah, that doesn't sound like it. I'm like, no, it doesn't sound like it to me either. So they said, okay, we'll get back to you. A month later, they call and say, just want you to know, we're not going to pursue this anymore. They had said before, we may or may not find anything, and we may or may not move forward with it depending on what we, you know, no matter what we find. It may be too many resources or too difficult to prove, or it may not be worth it, but or we may find nothing, we're just, you'll never know. And I was like, well, could you at least tell me like what happened to me? No. I'm like, well, you know, but I got kids, man. Like, did they break into my house? Are they following me? Like, one HubSpot guy, a former very high-level guy, wanted to meet me right when it happened. He's like, I think I know what happened. Meet me in Lexington at 5 o'clock. And I'm like, okay, dude, you know? And then he calls me. I'm like, go in there. He's like, can't do it. And I'm like, why? He's like, I think he might be followed. I was like, what the fuck, dude? Like, come on. And like, seriously, he's like, you don't know who you're messing with. I'm like, click. I'm like, oh my God, right? This is the most exciting story I've ever had in my whole life, and I don't know what it is, right? Like, this is like the ultimate worst thing that ever happened to a journalist, right? Like, you know, you stumbled across Watergate, but you just walked away. Like, you're like, whoa, okay, you know? Like, great. Whoop-de-doo, you know? Like, so I do a FOIA request, and people tell me that'll never work. You never get a FOIA request. You'll never, criminal investigator, you never get a FOIA request. So I'm like, okay, whatever. Filed it. And like months later, I get this thing, here's some FOIA docs from the FBI. And it turns out it wasn't trying to get my book, it was trying to extort people to not publish the book, according to these FBI, at least that was the allegation. HubSpot did an investigation, they hired a law firm to do the investigation. The law firm handed that information over, or some version of that, over to the feds. And the feds had that. And so what you can see in the FBI documents is, here's what we're investigating. They tried to gather information about people involved in the book deal in order to manipulate and extort them to railroad the book and prevent its publication. And I'm thinking, the hacking seemed like Rupert Pupkin, but this seems like pure Rupert Pupkin. You know, like the Rupert Pupkin reference is the king of comedy, a guy who really wants to be on the Johnny Carson show decides that the best way to do it is to kidnap Johnny Carson, tape him to a chair, hold a gun to his head and say, unless you let me do stand up, I'm gonna kill the host, right? Like, way stupid crime, like the stupidest crime ever. I was like, wait a minute, you were trying to extort people? Like, even if it worked, like, I would just go sell the book to someone else. Like, or if you killed my agent, I would get another. I like my agent, but I would get another one, you know? Or maybe it was me, but I never heard anything, right? So then it's even weirder and worse, right? And that's the last I know. Like that. And then the Globe had done a FOIA request in parallel with mine. So I got mine, and like a week later, the Globe's like, hey, we got these FOIA docs. And like, so anyway. And they ran a story about it, but that's all I know. There's still other documents that haven't been released yet that I've also FOIA'd, I'm hoping to get, which maybe would tell more of the story. Again, I think I'm gonna live the rest of my life thinking like there was some great story and I just like totally, totally blew it, you know? But, yeah. Oh, sorry. Oh, one, okay. Yeah, I think no, I'm sorry, I didn't mean that. I think so. I mean, I was surprised. I was most surprised by the response on LinkedIn to an article. It was sort of tangential. It's off the book, but I mean, like, but the same subject, but just about age and discrimination. I was really shocked and taken aback by that, and I didn't realize there were that many people, or maybe I sort of was aware of it, but I never, you feel it more viscerally when they all start writing to you, you know? So that surprised me. I didn't realize, I think that struck a nerve. And I thought maybe I was the only one feeling like I was Grandpa Simpson running around yelling at clouds. And then I realized partly I am, but partly it is like there is that. So I was surprised by that. And I think there is a generational story there. And you know, and it gets reduced to this thing of like, well, you hate millennials. I don't hate millennials. I actually wanted to work with young people. I was sitting in the media business at Newsweek and Forbes watching all these people my age or older or even younger who are like, this internet thing, I don't know, like waiting for the internet to go away, you know, like we can get back to the old days. And I was inside those places going, Jesus Christ, like, you know, we got to move. So I really wanted to go work with young media people to figure out like what's happening next in our business. So I don't really have any, you know, hatred of millennials. I just think diversity is a somewhat subtle point that gets lost on Twitter, where it's just like, you know, screw you, old man, you know, kind of thing. But so I was not surprised by that part of the response. I sort of expected that, like the, you know, the negative stuff I expected. I was taken aback by positive response, which is, you know, I'm sort of always expect the worst. And anyway, I think that's the last question we have, but we can talk and sign books. And thank you very much for coming.
Thank you.
Okay,
I'm perfectly willing to believe that it was not sort of a direct sort of like order coming down, like get this guy, like stop him. I'm also willing to believe that it was implicit, though, that like this guy needs to be stopped.